Welcome to Wasatch Weekends. I'm your host, Ben Roof. We've got a great show in store for you today with the 40th annual Sundance Film Festival in full swing. We spoke to the hosts of the Live Your Dream podcast about their activation here at the film festival. We also spoke to correspondent and investigative journalist Miriam Van Zeller about her new show. And we've also got Katie Wang, who told us all about the Sundance Film Festival.
So Sundance, as we are on the eve, they have the most submissions they've ever had. Over 17,000 films were submitted this year, and they actually accepted the fewest number of films ever because they've scaled back the film festival. They've reduced some of the venues. They're eliminating some of the bigger venues on the second half of film festivals. So normally there's about 128 films that are being screened. This year it's 90. So it's going to be kind of a more concentrated boutique experience, I think, but still some great films that have been in creation for the past couple of years. The pipeline is definitely full given the 17,000 submissions. But there's a great film about Frida Kahlo that's coming in, a documentary that's told from her diaries that I'm looking forward to. There's an episodic film called Penelope about a 16-year-old that kind of doesn't find her place in the world, so goes off into the wilderness to find kind of a new place for herself, which I think is kind of an interesting theme there. There's a film called Kneecap, which is about a Gaelic hip-hop band, and it's the first Irish language film to premiere at the Sundance Film Festival. So kind of their origin story. Lots of films about music, Luther Vandross, Devo, Lollapalooza. So kind of something for everyone, but it's a really eclectic mix this year, and we're just looking forward to, again, seeing some great films that'll kind of pique our interest, intrigue us, challenge us, entertain us, as they always do at the Sundance Film Festival. So yeah, coming up in a week, stay tuned.
Well, it sounds incredible. I can't wait. So let me ask you this. How do they whittle down 17,000 selections to just 90? What's the selection process like for the Sundance Film Festival?
So they have a huge amount of programmers who are fantastic at what they do. But what's interesting, I think, about Sundance is one, they're tracking films as they come along. So there are a lot of films that have been in labs that are now coming out into feature length films. So they have some films that they kind of know are going to be in the festival at some point. So they're kind of keeping track of those. Obviously there's new submissions, new artists that are coming in. But interestingly, what I think is interesting is that each film has to be watched three times. So they have the main programming team, and presumably they whittle down what they've seen, and then they have other programming teams watch the films. So each film has been watched at least three times before they make a decision on, is it going to get in or not? Or is this a film that we're going to kind of keep on the back burner and maybe track and bring in not that particular film, but maybe works from that same director another time. So this is the 40th anniversary of the Sundance Film Festival. So second half, there'll be some more films that are for repertory films from their catalog. Napoleon Dynamite, kind of famously here in Utah, will be coming back. Steven Soderbergh will be here. I think he's one of the tributes. I'm not sure what they call it here at Sundance, but he's someone that will be honored since Sex, Lives, and Videotape kind of put Sundance on the map when it came out back in the day. So just it'll be interesting to see kind of how they mix in the history of the Sundance Film Festival with what's going on currently. And it's not just films. I mean, people, I think, often forget that they have lots of talks, filmmaker panels, and those are always fantastic. So if you are in town for the festival, definitely take an opportunity to check out some of those kind of, it's not even like secondary opportunities, but it's just non-film events that are fantastic and really are, should be kind of top of your list. But generally speaking, people kind of gravitate towards the films because it's a film festival, of course. But take that opportunity to see something slightly different and see these filmmakers, in their own words, what they're doing, what they find interesting, where they see the future of film going.
Oh, Welcome back to Wasatch Weekends. Live Your Dreams podcast is a podcast about how artists manage to make careers out of their art and what it takes to really live their dreams. And we spoke to the host of the show about what they're doing here at the Sundance Film Festival. Let's take a look.
Now, it is our favorite time of year at Park City. It is the Sundance Film Festival, and joining us today are the official podcast coverage of Live Your Dreams podcast with Joe and Chris. How are you, gentlemen?
Very well,
Kimberly,
thank you.
How are you? Great to see you.
Great to see you as well. So you, Live Your Dreams podcast, love the podcast, listen to a lot of great episodes. You've had some incredible guests on it, and now you're officially covering Sundance Film Festival. So tell me all about Live Your Dreams and how you got started.
Oh, you know, Chris and I are just incredibly blessed. What we really wanted to do was create a podcast to showcase people that are, again, the title of the show, Living Your Dreams, right? There's so many people, especially in the entertainment industry and the arts, that they need a platform to showcase their work, but more importantly, to make sure that you have a group of supporting you that are all together. All of us that are artists, entrepreneurs, we all go through the struggles. So we wanted to have a platform to be able to present new entrepreneurs and new artists to connect with older artists that are actually established, to find a case to kind of motivate each other to pursue their dreams. And Chris has been a fantastic co-host with me, very, very blessed.
Absolutely. Now, you both are actors, producers, and have been in the entertainment business for a long time. So how did you make that transition into content creators and creating this podcast?
Well, it's kind of interesting because we've been content creators with regard to film and TV for quite a while now, years. Actually, Joe and I partners for at least a decade with this business. However, we had a writer's strike followed by a SAG strike, which is the actor's strike, that basically left us where we couldn't do film and TV. We started a podcast, and it was something that we can do. That was a SAG signatory project, and we were able to move forward without crossing any picket lines and be able to now give a platform for people to speak. So I always said that we had our film shown around the world to tell stories that people can identify with. Now we have guests on our podcast that share their story and their journey, the ups and downs, the obstacles they must face in order to move forward during trying times like we had.
Yeah, and you know, I have my brother is also in the entertainment industry, so I totally understand the, you know, how do you keep doing things and keep things rolling, but also, you know, make sure that you're showing solidarity for the industry. So let's talk about Sundance. So you're officially going to be broadcasting live from Sundance, and you know, what are your expectations for this? And this is your first time doing it, so tell me all about it.
Well, we're so excited, right? First off, we're so excited, too, because our podcast is actually going to be covering a lot of the press events, so we're very excited about that. So during a lot of the screenings and a lot of the events, we'll be there as press covering it. But then every day from 12 to 5, we'll be at Colleagues on Main Street actually doing our podcast live. So we are excited to get everybody that's in there walking around Sundance, trying to figure out what they're doing, and the established people to have a voice, to have a place they can go, to talk about the films that are being showcased there. And not even just the films that are being showcased at Sundance, but the future films that are going to be there. There's so many great filmmakers that are going through Sundance for the first time. They may not know where to kind of go or how to kind of navigate the, you know, it's a very complex festival. So we kind of want to be the voice of those people, along with obviously those that are actually in the festival. So we just want to have a great platform to present everybody else's dreams. The show is about our guests 100%. We try to put the focus on them, what they're doing, where their aspirations are going to be, and what their project is actually going right now. So we're excited just to be a small part of this amazing festival and a small part of their journey. If we can be a part of getting that out there more, we're very excited about that.
Yeah, that's so cool. You'll be live broadcasting, and I think that's just a really fun thing to do and to involve the crowds and everybody that's there. So tell us a little bit more in detail. So you're at Colleagues, and what time are you starting? How long does it last?
So we'll be there. It seems, I believe our coordinator, Gene Hale, set that up. Great guy. People would get to see him. So we'll be there, I think, 12 to 5. From, I believe, it's the 18th to the 23rd, 12 to 5 every day we'll be there. We'll have a section blocked off. You'll see our posters. You'll see our camera set up. I have our amazing cameraman, Timothy Reeves, is going to be there. Our podcast powered by Blackmagic Designs. So we have a lot of great cameras set up. You'll see the whole thing. And Gene B. Hale will actually be going around and pulling people that are interested in coming on board and kind of forming the whole logistics of it. So great guy to kind of have it set up. And then Chris and I will be there having a great conversation with you. So very excited to get everybody on board. Please don't be shy. Please come up to us. We want to invite everybody on the show. This is not a show just for the people that have films in Sundance. Again, we want them on there as well. But we want everybody, aspiring filmmakers, artists, anybody who has a dream, we want to be able to broadcast your story. And we believe everybody is the future of this industry. We just want to be a small part of helping you.
Yeah, absolutely. Now, outside of the entertainment industry, and I just want to go back to some of the previous episodes, you've had entrepreneurs on the show. So talk to me about how you connect with these people and, you know, how you've really been highlighting what they do.
Well, I've always had a big network of people, myself as well as Joe. We're always out there. We know a lot of people. People have asked to come on the show. We basically have showcased entrepreneurs as well as actors, filmmakers, because they're telling their story. It's almost like a blueprint. They're giving you a playbook, play by play, how they did it, how they dealt with the obstacles, how they overcame them. It's basically, it's the feedback we've been getting has been, it's been inspirational as well as educational. We're very proud about that. So tune in, learn what you need to know from whoever you're listening to, and make it specific to you.
Yeah, absolutely, Chris. I mean, some of the great entrepreneurs like Dr. Kellyanne, she actually has a great bone broth that's out there in the world right now. Actually, I think Mario Lopez, one of her spokespeople for that object, is amazing. Just really people that are into the natural health remedies. We've had on people that are huge in architecture, that are developing buildings all around New York City, to, you know, inspiring artists like Marcus Suarez, who was an amazing artist for Prince, Madonna, and then actually suffered 8 strokes back to back to back and had to relearn to use his motor skills in every function. I mean, amazing, inspiring people, not just entrepreneurs, but just artists, everyone out there. And we're just blessed that we've had a lot of people coming out to us now as the show really has gotten a lot of traction. We're just blessed that they've been calling us up, wanting to come on the show, wanting to have a platform to kind of showcase that. But like Chris said, these people, again, like Dr. Kellyanne, a guy like Alan Stewart Jr., who's a major real estate developer in Connecticut, these people come on and they share their vision. They're an open book. So it's almost like you're getting a crash course for 45 minutes to kind of see what these people went through in their trials and tribulations to get to where they are. Quite inspiring. And then we also had on young artists, a young musician, 16 years old. She has her first album release out there right now on Spotify, iHeartRadio. You can check this stuff out. She's fantastic, Zoe. So we try to get everybody from the beginning of the spectrum all the way to the end, and we kind of get everyone in between. So just very blessed people want to be a part of it.
Yeah, absolutely. And those guests are definitely an inspiration to people who are trying to chase their dreams down as well. So what can we expect in the 2024 year and upcoming seasons?
This is going to be a great season, right? Upward and onward. Yeah. Actually, we're taking the show a lot on the road this season. So we closed out the first season January 4th, which is a great first season. Season 2, opening up at Sundance, which is going to be fantastic. Going on from there, we're going to be going to other festivals. We actually may be going to do a few interviews down in the islands, actually, as well. So we're going to be on the road a lot for season 2, which is kind of exciting for Chris and I and our team. A lot of traveling. So we're very blessed again. You know, Gene B. Hale, who set this up, who's our coordinator, Timothy Reeves, who's our main camera operator, and the rest of the team that's around us, our editors and everybody. We're blessed that we all get to spend a lot of time together. So being on the road is going to be fun, but we still have some amazing studio guests coming in this year as well. But mostly this will be an on the road season, but you know, maybe 5 to 10 episodes will be in our studios back in the New York City area.
Awesome. Well, congratulations on the wrap of season 1 and very exciting stuff for Sundance Film Festival. Can't wait to see all the content that you're putting out there. But you'll be at Kali Sports Bar from 12 to 5 from the 18th to the 23rd during Sundance.
Yes, 100%. Yep. And if anybody wants to contact us, you can email liveyourdreamspodcast@gmail.com. Our coordinator, Gene, will be handling that throughout the whole Sundance. So he'll be on there all the time. If anybody wants to drop an email, set something up, or just say, hey, you're going to come by and say hi. We'd love to know you're coming. So please feel free to email Gene. Feel free to contact us. If you want to come on the show, we're an open book. We want to say hello to everybody. We just can't wait to share your stories and Sundance the story with the world, because this is such an inspiring festival. There's so many amazing people. And as artists, we have to support each other and make the dreamers make the dreams go round.
It's the absolute truth. You know, we're all just living the dream. So we appreciate you both, Joe and Chris. Great to chat with you. Excited to see all the content that you're putting out at Sundance in season 2.
Kimberly, thank you so much. Thanks for having us on. We appreciate it.
Absolutely. Now stay tuned. We'll be back with more right after this.
Welcome back to the show. While we're talking about film and media and everything that goes into creating these interesting projects, we spoke to Miriam Van Zeller about the new season of her show Trafficked on Hulu, produced by National Geographic. Let's take a look.
Now, our next guest tackles some very important discussions that should be had. There are so many things that are happening outside of our normal day-to-day. Joining me today is the host of National Geographic's Traffic Underworlds with Mariana Van Zeller. Mariana, how are you this morning?
I'm doing great. Thank you so much for having me.
Great to have you here. Now, congratulations. Season 4 officially hit the airwaves last night and is on Hulu today. So talk to me a bit about Trafficked and what we can expect out of this next season.
Absolutely. So Trafficked is a show about black markets. So in every episode, we tackle a different black market. I think most people don't realize how these black and gray markets actually make up for half of the world's economies, but we actually know so very little about them. In this season, it happens to be my favorite season so far. We tackled some really important and relevant issues such as illegal immigration and fake counterfeit medication, sextortion, which is a crime that's on the rise. We've got 10 episodes that are sort of roller coaster rides into these very secretive underworlds.
I'd say all of the things that you've listed and are highlighting in the season are definitely hot topics right now, especially in current events. So talk to me a bit about, how did you get these stories? How did you connect with these people? This, as you mentioned, it is a multi-trillion dollar industry.
It's not easy. It's the hardest part of my job. I've gotten very used to being rejected because we get a lot of no's before we get a yes. But at the end of the day, I think it's several reasons that get people to talk to us. I think there's a level that people want to boast. These are some of the best traffickers, some of the best smugglers out there. And they usually, sometimes even their families don't know they do what they do. So we give them an opportunity behind a mask to sort of talk about what they do. I think there's a sense of impunity as well in many of these places, such as in Sinaloa and Mexico, where I've reported extensively. There's police corruption, there's government corruption, so they really don't see a downside to talking to an internationally recognized brand like National Geographic. And then at the end of the day, I think it's a human characteristic that we all share, this need to be understood. And I approach everyone that we meet always with empathy, and I tell them I'm here to try to understand why you do what you do, and I'm not here to judge, and that goes a really long way.
So Mariana, I'd love to understand, what is your passion behind telling these stories? What has inspired you and really motivated you to stay part of this project with National Geographic?
I've always been fascinated by these dark, secretive corners of the world. I think usually as a journalist, if you tell a journalist that there's a place in the world that you cannot go or a story you cannot report on, that is exactly what you want to do next. And I think that's been the case with me. But I also find it fascinating that there's this very parallel market, this very parallel economy that is happening parallel to the legal economy, parallel to the legal world. And yet, again, that sort of affects us all, that is all around us, and the knowledge that, you've got full organizations, newspapers, TV stations devoted to exploiting the ins and outs of the legal economy, and so little out there about these black markets. So I've devoted my entire life and my career to this.
What are you hoping that viewers will get out of this season?
I think we have to understand that we have a lot of broken systems in our country, that when we're talking about illegal immigration, for example, when you know that there are thousands of people that are dying trying to make it to the United States, and that the exploitation of these very vulnerable people is actually enriching the cartel and creating more violence, then we have to realize that there's a broken immigration policy in this country. When you have 20 million Americans that are having to buy their prescription drugs on the black market because they can't afford them here in the United States, there's something that we have to look at in terms of our healthcare system. So there's an accountability to all of this. We can point the finger at the criminals, but at the end of the day, we have to understand why these black markets exist.
That's exactly right. Now, where can we go to watch the show and to follow along on the journey?
So it airs every Wednesday at 9, 8 Central on National Geographic, and you can watch 8 of the 10 episodes now on Hulu as well.
Excellent. Well, Mariana, thank you so much for your investigative journalism and the work that you're doing. It's very important to expose these people and the industry that is running parallel, as you mentioned, alongside our normal legal operations. So we appreciate you.
Thank you for having me, Kimberly.
Absolutely. This.
Well, that's all the time we have for this Friday edition of Wasatch Weekends. Don't forget to tune in to our one-hour episode tomorrow morning, where we've got some wonderful business and health advice, as well as some delicious new recipes for you. Until then, this is Wasatch Weekends, and I've been your host, Ben Roof. Can't wait to see you next time.